You know, today is the midpoint of the course, and I have some ideas, you know, that what everybody is interested in, and what you are interested in terms of research projects also in the future. And so, you know, the material that you have in the printed version of the notes, and also you have the actual PPTs which are in color, so you will see that there's a lot of material there, and the way we have been going, it is just not possible to complete it by Friday. So based on your input in last 2 days, and also with some discussion with, you know, Professor Jain and Professor Paul, and particularly from your input, correct me if I am wrong, that I think that most of you are interested in flow control from the point of view of simulations. Maybe a little bit, some people may be interested in experiment, primarily simulations, and so using CFD and trying to see if you use some kind of a control mechanism, whether it is active or passive, whatever we have talked about, what is the outcome? So that is the focus. So you will find that lecture number 9 and lecture number 10 and tutorial number 9 and tutorial number 10, they primarily address the coupling of two disciplines, and that is the control theory as we know from theoretical point of view, which means there are certain now foundations of control theory based on what we call optimal control theory, based on the linear quadratic regulator or linear quadratic Gaussian, and then there's called a robust H infinity control theory. Now, nobody in the class, which is my understanding, either knows or interested in that as a research scholar or a M.Tech student or an undergraduate student. So I think that we will not cover in the course those 4 lectures. But if you are interested, you have the PPTs and you can follow it, but I think that that will not be actually a useful thing to do, and also we don't have time. So we will concentrate, try to finish up to 8 lectures and 8 tutorials. And I think that even within that scope, the way we are moving, I will have to again extract the most relevant material. Okay, so there are a lot of slides, you know, which are repetitive or not very much more information. So that is how we'll proceed. Okay, so you will find that I may talk about a few lectures and tutorials, so it will be all not the way we originally planned, but it will be still a seamless, smooth presentation. Okay. So you will not find, you know, any difficulty in following what we have done. All right? So that is the plan, and so that's why you will see that I thought, you know, it will be interesting to talk about one of the actuators that we have not talked about so far in the active flow control, and that was the sweeping jet actuator. And that are being considered very seriously, as I showed you some applications. So that is why I am going on chapter lectures 8. And also it has some interesting aspects to it which are different. So I thought that I will do that and spend some time so that you have another exposure to one of the important, most recent way to provide the control authority. So the control authority is very important, as you know. If the system that you are trying to control is such that it requires a greater modification of the objective that you are interested in controlling. And it turns out that for large scale applications, the synthetic jets have not been very successful. And although they have pluses that we talked about, and if you look at the passive control devices, they have some results, but they are marginal. And the hybrid devices, as you saw yesterday, with the inclusion of the synthetic jet, did not do much for very simple cases. We have not done any complicated cases, which I demonstrated so far. So the sweeping jet has a good potential. And that is not the end of it. People are investigating some other ideas. And maybe in the future, you know, somebody from this group of people will come up with some other more powerful ideas. So that's why I thought I will do that. And then after that, we will again, you know, show some additional lecture and some tutorial. So let us see how much we can cover tomorrow, and tomorrow again, today, and then we'll try to do again a mix of lecture and tutorials, and then Friday. So lecture number 9, lecture number 10, and tutorial number 9 and tutorial number 10, they are altogether different than the rest of the course. And I don't think that it is useful to spend time on that. And they are not very practical also, and they basically deal with the closed loop control. And they require the background that I understand that most of you have not taken that kind of a course. And they are primarily more theoretical than practical. And so CFD is just a very kind of a nominal part of those lectures. So that is how, you know, we will proceed today. Okay, so I think that we want to start with this. I decided not to talk about lecture number 7 right now, and that you can read yourself actually, because that deals with the actuators that we have talked about a lot. Okay, so we have talked about the synthetic jet actuators a great deal. Okay, so that lecture number 7 basically deals with the CFD modeling of the synthetic jet actuators. And the main thing about that lecture is that those particular, even synthetic jet actuators, their control authority is depends on how you design them. So we may later on touch upon that a little bit, because that is an important part, that how do you increase the control authority of even of a synthetic jet actuators. And as I mentioned yesterday, that the entire course is focused on the fluidic actuators. So the actuator itself has fluid as a medium, in contrast to say plasma actuators or some other type of actuators that do not use fluid as a medium. Okay, so that is what I'm going to start today, and I'll try to go over it relatively quickly to again set the idea about that why is it different. Now, of course, you know, one of the things that happens in active flow control is that if you are going to have more control authority, there are two things you can do. One is, of course, you can modify the design a little bit so that the way the fluid behaves creates a stronger jet, and that imparts a stronger momentum. So that is a simple principle. So that is where, in terms of the geometry, the cavity of the actuator plays a role. Frequency, of course, plays a role. amplitude plays a role. So we might touch upon that after this sweeping actuator, because as I said, there's a more recent one, and they seem to be very powerful. And of course, to the control objective that of the sweeping jet actuator. Now what it is shown you, what is being shown here is that you have inflow is coming in here. So you are pushing in the fluid here, and then there are two channels here. One you see the bottom and one you see at the top. So they are may not be totally symmetric, but they are shown to be here almost symmetric, which are called the feedback channels. So they are basically nothing but the pipes in a way. Now that pipe cross section can be circular or non-circular. So you have a float coming in, and then it goes through these two feedback channels, and so float comes in from this side. That basically that is a mixing chamber, okay? So the first the flow is coming from that side, and this is the outlet. So you see that it goes from here and exits through this exit and goes in this direction, okay? So the direction of the flow that comes in is in this fashion, all right? Then what happens is that later on, once this happens, that you are basically oscillating the flow here. So when it is in a certain phase, then the flow of the jet that is coming out of this nozzle, which is an oscillatory jet, it goes in this direction. Then after say half a period, it changes the direction, and then it goes in the opposite direction. So it is sweeping in the sense that it goes from here in half a cycle of the inflow cycle of the jet, and the other one it goes this way. So it basically sweeps the outer flow from one direction to the other, okay? So outer flow, you will have a flow that you need to control. So that flow may be on a flat plate, or that may be on an aerofoil, or that may be on a wing, or that may be on the back surface of a truck, or whatever you are trying to reduce the skin friction or separation. So that is basically the concept. So the oscillation of this jet requires of course some energy, but what you can do is that you can modify this oscillation with a larger variation in amplitude that can provide a more control authority compared to a synthetic jet. So that is the whole idea. Of course, you know, the way you design the feedback channel and the mixing chamber, you can decide jet looks. So I remember that the very first day I showed you that this has really worked very well on the Boeing 757 tail to achieve the control of the yaw. And so the control surface, which is like a rudder or some other control surface to control the yaw, has been eliminated. So that saves a lot of things, and I showed you that particular example in detail when we talked about it on the very first day. So they are now getting a lot of traction, and I think that in the future they will be probably implemented more and more, larger control authority. As I have been telling you from day one, that in order to investigate any new idea, you have to have an experiment, and then most of you do CFD, then you have to do the CFD, and then you can validate the CFD against the experiment. And then of course you can extend the envelope of the parameters when you are doing a validated CFD code, and then you can do optimization and other things. So we have the same philosophy in every kind of discussion that we are having. So what you see here is a photograph, or it's more like a shadow graph of a jet that is coming out from this actuator. And so what you see here are three different kind of images, but basically what it shows is that there's a turbulent jet and it goes this way and that way. So it has, so what you see here is a smoke visualization, and then you see here is a Eulerian representation of this, which means this is a CFD solution that in particularly half of the cycle. And then you, what you see here is the what is called is that you can reduce it, the PIV data, by what is called a Lyapunov exponent, without, you know, going into that. Basically captures the more intricate features of the internal structures like better. So now what you see is that you can have, of course, all these kind of streamlines. So this is a one configuration that I showed you before. This is a different one, and you can see that in one half cycle, to in this particular case, the streamlines will go like this, and then in another case it may change the direction to the other direction. The main idea is that the inflow jet is oscillating with certain frequency, certain amplitude, and in a half a cycle it goes in one direction, half a cycle it goes in the other direction. Okay. All right. Of course, it generates vorticities, and I told you in every case of active flow control, even a ramp or even a vortex generator or any other passive device also generates vorticity. But that is not strong enough. Now, in case of synthetic jet, again, the vorticity is not strong enough. So vorticity has to be generated, and a positive momentum has to be created to energize the boundary layer, and that is the whole idea. But how do you generate it, and how do you energize the boundary layer, and how much control authority you require, and how do you integrate it with the main system? All those issues have to be addressed in every case. So that is where this difficulty comes up in trade-off. And when you all do the integration, whether it's beneficial or not, because it's in the weight, of course, the. So now you. Yet the flow field, of course, the concentration is here in the vorticity, and as it moves forward to the entire domain, this is what you expect. The idea of the design here is that so that is where the optimization issue comes in, integrated with the CFD, because is it better this or this is better? Okay, so it is better to have a spread of vorticity like this, because ultimately it is both are basically imparting the momentum, but the way the momentum is being imparted and the area that is covered is very different. And this is not the these are two examples I have given you, and for which there is a data available, but in general you can use your optimization algorithm and have a different design. So now if you have this, and you have to just make a qualitative decision based on the physics, okay, imagining that there is a flat plate here and you are trying to reduce the skin friction, not worry about any separation issue, which is another thing of we are interested in controlling, which one do you think you are going to choose? All right, so yesterday we decided between the ramp and the hybrid, and we had a vote, right? So let us vote it, and again I will ask the four ladies to vote that you like this or this. So you want to start, we will start with the new one. Utkrishi Singh. Which one you like? Okay. All right. So behind you is Nisha. So which one you like? Huh? Okay. And so the last one there is Sonia. Okay. And Manjari. So it's a unanimous vote. Anybody opposed in here from the opposite party? So you can see that this is based simply on the physics, and that is why this is the one that is being used. But this is not optimal either. But the point I'm making is that a lot of decision you can make before you are plunging into the optimization based on some calculation that you have done by looking at the flow field. So here you have a concern. Not to spend some time. So that is the So if you are going to look at the entire jet from the inlet all the way to the outlet, you have to consider all this three-dimensional grid. Okay? And then see what the effect is. Now in this case I can tell you ahead of time that the two-dimensional model result and three-dimensional model result are totally different. So you have to swallow the bullet and do the three-dimensional work. Okay? But to practice and the CFD software, to practice the grid generation, to practice the implementation of the boundary condition, to practice that how a periodic solution can be generated, I think it's worth trying a two-dimensional problem. So there is a lot of merit in trying the two-dimensional part. But actually, if you want to implement anything or want to get a real answer for real application, then you have to do the three-dimensional. But two-dimensional work has a lot of merit. Okay? You want to do that, what I showed you before, by using CFD. And the reason I'm saying is that one of my students, he again took the experimental data, which I have been telling you, all the calculations that I'm showing you here are based on the work of my students. So he tried to do the 2D CFD to see whether he can learn everything and what the limitations are. And the reason I made that statement is that the experimental data, when he tried to match, it was so way off that, you know, it was almost impossible. And that was the reason, not of turbulence modeling, by the way. That was the reason that it is inherently a three-dimensional problem. So every problem is not the same. You have to identify what is the limitation of that particular problem. Is it the grid resolution that is a problem? Or is it the turbulence model that is a problem? Or is it the way you are using the unsteady algorithm is a problem, or it is the inherent three-dimensionality of the problem? So this is an example where the problem is inherently three-dimensional. And as I showed you in the previous slide, it's a very complex kind of a domain that you have to consider. And these are the various dimensions in an experiment that was used. So, and this is an instantaneous, that is at a given time step during the periodic cycle, the flow. So now you can see when you are comparing the experiment with the simulation, and this is called the proper orthogonal decomposition, which is a good way to basically decompose a unsteady flow field. Have you heard about this POD, anybody? What it means is that a unsteady flow, okay, or any unsteady, let us say in mathematics, you have an unsteady wave form. So, like, yeah, go ahead, speak.
So like,
Yeah. So suppose you have unsteady behavior is like this. Okay. So any unsteady wave, so this is the T, this is say some kind of amplitude, right? So you can decompose it in a Fourier series. And so you have what you call is a fundamental mode and secondary mode and third mode and fourth mode. So in the same context, what you said in the context of stability, it is a similar thing. So your answer was in a different context was correct answer. So what I'm saying is that to analyze such a complicated waveform that may occur during the process of simulation or even in measurement, what you do is that you see that what is the most dominant modes or what are the most dominant 2, 3, 4 modes. So that is called a proper orthogonal decomposition. And also that is a more mathematical jargon because all these modes have to have certain properties, the way you decompose. So, but the bottom line here is, this is mode 1 and mode 2. And this is the PIV. And this is mode 1 and mode 2. All right? Now, this is the CFD. So, what you see here, by now everybody knows SST, right? Sir Sundar Lal, right? Trust. I just went to the Sir Sundar Lal hostel yesterday. All right? So this is a Sir Sundar Lal Trust. Everybody knows SST, right? Who doesn't know SST? After 2.5 days, I expect at least one person to know what SST is. You are a CFD stalwart here sitting. Nobody knows SST? Huh? Study? How many of you have used ENSYS? Raise your hands. Huh? So many people have used ENSYS? How long have you used ENSYS? Anybody, how many? 1 month, 2 months, half an hour, 20 seconds? How many of you are doing your thesis or research using ENSYS? Yeah, you raise your hand, sir. Yeah. You are a dollar. You are what is your, you are doing M-Tech or what are you doing? Smart man. Okay, anybody really knew about it and was shy to speak? Even this is a better guess. Is a Sir Sundar Lal Trust. At least you had to speak something. Which one? What is it? Single stream transport. Single stream transport. That's a guess. Okay. In science, you know, nowadays people are using this calculator. And I ask a student 2 plus 2 is a 3.999. This is a fundamental model, and I have had so many slides yesterday in the presentation. So that's why I say, you know, before you come here next day, read it. There were slides saying only two turbulence models. One was SA, Spallard Alamaras model, and the other most widely used is the SST. And there is a shear stress transport model. Okay. So, thank you, sir. You have saved the flag. Just like, you know, you saved the flag yesterday. You can call K omega, but if you don't remember K omega, that's a complete answer. SST K omega because there's two equations. Equation for K and K, for omega. Omega is like a pseudo vorticity. Okay. And after I'm done with this, then I'm going to spend the entire effort on the turbulence modeling. There is very, very important CFD. As I told you, that is the one you can blame if nothing works. All right? But SST, somebody said there was shear is, what did you say, sir? No, you. The person in the yellow shirt. Okay. So, there could be, as I said, this is like single stream transport is still related to fluid mechanics. But if you are a social scientist, and that is the hostel I lived in, I think this is a good answer to say subsurface law trust. You have to be very precise at this stage. And so many of you are working in CFD, in ANSYS Fluent. This should be almost something is your second nature, actually, to know a few terminus models. So anyway, what I'm showing you here is that this calculation has been done by using the SST model. Okay? All right, I cannot answer your question that how much time it took. But this is, what you see here is quite good, actually. It's not bad. Okay? But it is a qualitative picture of the results. The quantitative pictures, we don't know how good it is, but it turns out that it will be not that bad. So now you go into more detail during the cycle. So now you are going from 0, 120 degree, 180 degree, to 240 degree, to 300. So you go in the entire cycle during up and down, up and, so it is down, it is up. So it spans the whole domain. And so what you see here is that these are streamlines, the CFD and this calculations are fairly good. So this is the validation, right? And I told you that validation is very important in whatever you do. So now I'm going to show you a video that has been made by some of these people. And these are the people who provided me the experimental data. And this person is now, works in St. Louis in the in Boeing company, and yeah, it's working. You have to click actually only once. So you can now see in the experiment how the flow visualization looks like. So you see that this is a sweeping jet. Jet comes in, jet goes down in half cycle and half cycle. So one thing you can immediately see, the power of this jet, of course you can even increase the power, but it covers the very large domain. In comparison to the static jet. Okay, so that was a smoke picture. So now when you take the data, there you cannot take the data, even with the instrument in the entire region. So then you have compartmentalize, part of it, and so that's why you see those dotted lines. So now you slow the speed, and then you see that how more clearly you can see the sweeping effort. So if you increase the speed, you can really have a bigger domain, and otherwise you have a smaller domain. Now, in order to have very fine structures, then you do what is called the Lyapunov exponent, which is a basically mathematical extraction of the very fine structures of the jet as it sweeps from the bottom to the top. So this is a mathematical way to look at it. So you can basically see that how the various structures are forming and how this jet is interacting. So it basically goes up and goes down during the half and half cycles. So this is the experiment. So if you are doing the CFD, you have to see that how do you really simulate such a complicated thing. So you can see how complex the vortex structure is here. And it is possible actually, if you have enough great resolution, to really capture all these, not maybe total final details, but most of the relevant details of this jet. So this is the jet these days that people are using in the real applications in the aeroplanes and in the considering it for the drag and say big trucks like a trailer tractor and so on. The synthetic jets have not been successful because they don't have the control authority. Okay, I'll come back to it, that how do you define the boundary condition, because boundary condition is very important. So I will come back to it in a few minutes. So let's try this, which basically now shows, that was only the sweeping jet experiment. Now it shows that how it interacts with a flat plate boundary layer, that is where you want to reduce the drag. So this is the experimental tunnel that was used by the person at Boeing that I mentioned, Rene Rosagillo, and he provided us the experimental data, and actually provided me these videos to show here. And so I am doing now the calculations, and one of the students is still working on it. You see, this is the oscillatory field in a quiescent environment, which I already showed you, that vertical going left and right. So now I will show you, or this video will show you, that how does it work when a boundary layer is added or a cross flow is added. So cross flow means it's a boundary layer coming on a plate, and the sweeping jet is normal to the plate. So now you can see that jet is coming out, and the flow, the boundary is coming that way. Now you can have an orientation which is different. So now it goes this way and that way, and it covers this area. And as a result of that, when you have the boundary layer, then it must be able to reduce the drag or skin friction bigger than the other one. So this is a cross flow interaction of the jet that is coming out of there. And this is basically localized, you know, flow that is being shown here, but the spread on the rest of the area is not shown to keep it basically clear. And this, what you are being seen here, is basically a water medium in which the dye has been put in to show the vortical structures that matter, that which are basically the result of. Now you see that this splitting of the vortices that occurs because there is a cross flow. But remember that every time I have talked about you that you had to have a momentum, otherwise there will not be any change in the flow control for the skin friction. Now this is a much more, you know, mathematically defined structures using the Lyapunov exponent concept. So this is a flat plate boundary layer, as I said, and so you cannot see, you know, that, but this is overall a structure that is interacting with the boundary layer. No, this is all experiment. This all PIB and all experiment. It all the videos are experimental, no computation at all. What does? No, I mean there are various ways. If you have, for example, the smoke, okay, then you can have a Schillerian system, you can have shadow graphs. So what kind of flow visualization technique you use, it depends on the medium. So the medium is air, which is the case in case of, say, for example, most of the things that we are interested in. Okay, you are not, that aeroplane flies in air, the truck moves in air, unless until you are interested in something, you know, underwater, like submarines and so on.
So that model is made by Felix or?
Made by what?
Model.
Yeah. Transparent, yeah. Because it, as I said, for a better visualization, you know, it was a water medium in which you could inject the dye, and that is one of the ways to look at it. But if you had air, you could use, you know, smoke. But that will not give as crisp a picture of the understanding of the vortex. So it depends on, you know, it is your choice what you want to do. But in air, advantage is that you can have a better speed. Water is a slower speed. The density of water is 1,000 more than the density of air, right? It's 1,000 kilogram per meter cube versus 1 kilogram per meter cube. And of course, the viscosity of air is much smaller, right? You know,
this was in water.
Yeah.
Both of them.
The yeah, right. That tunnel that was shown, yeah, and is all everything. And in a water also the PIV is much more effective. Yeah. No, as I told you, the experiment in the air were well established. You can have a synthetic jet and pump in the air, and you have a boundary layer which is made of air. And then you can visualize. So how do you visualize? Suppose something is happening in this room, which is air. Let me ask you a simple question. There is air in this room, and you want to visualize what is happening, right? What is the best way to do it? Huh? What? You have to think fundamentally, man, after so many days. I mean, what do you mean by colors? You are not to play holy here, are you? You can play holy, right? What I'm saying is that suppose you want to look what is happening in that corner. Is there a vortex? You have used the word Schlieren so many times. What is the principle of Schlieren? Tell me. What is the principle of Schlieren? Knowing the word Schlieren is no good. What is the meaning of Schlieren? Schlieren is some guy, but what did he do? But a single person is, everybody is choosing. Everybody is choosing. Absolutely. Now they had a tunnel, they put the water. You know, if you have taken a first course, there is what is called a Reynolds pipe experiment, right? To see when the flow becomes turbulent, right? Yeah. Have you ever seen a institution in which that experiment is performed in air? Don't go there. I'm saying that in every basic course, Reynolds experiment. like what? Every all right. If smoke then smoke visualization. So it show you. Take the cigarette and what is going to happen that it visualization. So if you are interested in it, you have to have a dye for the air. So instead of using a dye from your fountain pen, which nobody has anymore, so a blue or a red or a green, you have to have a smoke to look at the dye that moves. That is called a smoke visualization. So when you have a chimney, for example, and the smoke is coming out, you can see the world. You can see the plume. Now similarly, when you have a smoke coming out, or you have a jet coming out of an aeroplane, you can see how this is moving, because it mixes with the air and you see all this behavior. So if you want to do the experiment in the air, which is a real experiment if you want to implement for the aeroplane, right? Then you have to use, if you want to just see it, all right? But the point, idea here is that you want to see it and you see it cheaply, but in a great detail, what is happening? Water is a very good medium. And now we know what the structure is. And then you say, okay, let me take that experiment and develop a CFD code. And once we validate that CFD code, then we can expand the parametric space, because then you have to change small changes in the speed, small changes in the time period, domain, whatever you want, the optimized shape, and then you can see what really happens. And then you can come up with a better answer. So that is the message repeatedly, that what really happens. Okay? But you have to think from a fundamental point of view, and what is happening. Happening. Right? I'm diagnosed. Some people know by now. But this is important. So how many of you are kitne log puri chalte hain? Puri hain? How many people acha ek this is nice maybe in one to 50, you know. So ek aadmi puri chalte hain. Right? Jab aapki kadhai mein aapne puri oil dal diya aur puri dal di. समझे और उसके बाद आपने कोई वो पानी से वो हाथ हाथ धो के वो छींटा पड़ गया क्या होता है नो नो एकदम से आवाज होती है बड़ी जोर से लगता है बबल फट गया और अगर ज्यादा छींटे डाल दिए तो और अपने को भी नुकसान पहुंच सकता है वो जब छींटा आप डालते हैं उसमें या थोड़ा सा पानी डल गया या ड्रॉपलेट पड़ गई तो आप इन्हें कभी सोचा है कि वो क्यों फट जाता है दिस इज करेक्ट व्हाट इज द फंडामेंटल रीजन दैट इट बर्स्ट प्रेशर दैट इज ट्रू प्रेशर अगर वो चेंज होगा और बाहर का ज्यादा होगा अंदर का कम होगा तो हो जाएगा नहीं लेकिन बहुत सी चीज़ें होती हैं आपका जो है गैस का सिलेंडर जो है जिससे आप कुकिंग करते हैं उसमें ही तो प्रेशर की प्रॉब्लम है वो तो बर्स्ट नहीं होता क्योंकि वो स्टील का बना हुआ है व्हाट इज द फंडामेंटल फिजिक्स दैट मेक्स इट ए बबल ब्रेक दैट इज द सरफेस टेंशन सो द सरफेस टेंशन कैन नॉट विदस्टैंड the pressure difference. ये जो आप जब suck करते हैं straw, that is based on surface tension, right? तो वो अगर पानी है तो ऊपर चढ़ जाता है और वो मरकरी है तो वो नीचे दबा रहता है, because it is the weight surface tension, right? So surface tension is the one, but suppose you reverse the process. अगर आपने कहा कि ज़्यादा तेल तो बड़ा महंगा हो गया, पानी में पूरियां बनाओ, राइट? तो पानी आपने डाल दिया कढ़ाई में और खूब गर्म किया और पूरी डाल दी, राइट? अब उसमें आप ऑयल डाल दीजिए, क्या होगा? ना फ्लो तो करेगा, उसका तो डेंसिटी कम है, वो कभी भी बर्स्ट नहीं होगा, उसकी कितनी ड्रॉपलेट डाल दीजिए. तो रिवर्स प्रोसेस में जो है वो फिनोमेना ऑफ सरफेस टेंशन इज सो मच, सरफेस टेंशन ऑफ द फ्लूइड इज सो मच दैट इट कैन नॉट, द प्रेशर डिफरेंस विल नॉट बी एबल टू डू इट. सो द रीजन आई एम ब्रिंगिंग दोज स्टोरीज फॉर यू, ओके, दैट इन एवरीडे लाइफ यू सी सो मच ऑफ फिनोमेना ऑफ फ्लूइड एंड यू नो सो मच ए फंडामेंटल प्रिंसिपल, that if you start learning why it is happening, I think that all this flow control will become very easy for you. Okay? All right? So, anyway, let's move on. You know, I mean, there are too many stories to say. Now you ask this question, now we are back to the question that we did the experiment, we have some idea about the structures. We applied even some mathematics like Lyapunov exponent to understand the more detailed, higher level of mathematics than even if you have a fractal structure. The hydraulic diameter, if you have a in it. So what you have is in this case, which corresponds to the experiment that I showed you, this jet domain, how big it is, okay, and here our interest is also that you can do the flat plate boundary layer and so on, but it is only for a simple case of interaction of the jet with a flat. This is where experience and qualitative understanding. Not a mesh here, because again, here, average solution. We use Stokes. In this case, we use the SST model. Right, so that is shear stress transport K omega model, and so whether you take it is not going to hurt you if you take double the size, but then you will be calculating for longer time and it's not necessary. So what are the places that you have to put the boundary layer by the boundary condition to answer your question? So you have a condition here which you know, that is the jet. So you know the time period, you know what algorithm to use, you know what is the particular transient algorithm in the fluent, right? So now you come here and this will take care of itself. So what? So the plate is here, bottom. So it is no. What is the boundary? Yes. because there is no other. About right. This pressure outlet here, and on the other side tunnel, they are very straightforward boundary conditions. They are not really anything very complicated. What is complicated in this case is to choose the right turns in solver, and how do you basically take that enormous amount of data which is generated during that time. So you will have to come up with a time average statistic in which you can extract most of the useful information, which is basically influencing the drag on the flat plate. Okay? So you will have to have a lot of grids here. Yeah. Oops. Okay. So you will have to have a lot of grid at the bottom. So now you can see other slides. So you see that this shows the various 3D grid in the domain and how the grid will be, and then this shows how the grid will be more closer here, less here, because the viscous effects are wherever to the plate. And then of course this much grid actually. I told you that this is the one that because the spread of the jet is higher. You want to make sure that even the profile of the boundary. Now, where is your sublet? Below 10. And where is the wake? This is the guy. And so this is the log region. Okay. And so why does it, this is supposed to be linear? Why is it nonlinear? The log scale. You look at here, what is this? 100. Number I gave, that is delta over 3. You have to validate all these are the parameters. This is the error. So this is the validation which is very important as I kept in. Which again shows the PIV, and this is where you see this is this micro very and these are all time. To show the experiment and the CD. It shows basically the results for the actual data that has been collected by PIV and also with your CFD model with SST turbulence model. And you know there are too many details here. So there is a CFD and there is the experiment is this red point. And then there is for various values of R, you see that there are differences and changes. And these are, of course, you can have more plots to see what happens in time accurate solution, phase averaging, and so on. But these are, you know, not going into detail, it's not important. But what important is the whole philosophy of why are we doing it? Because it has a higher control authority, number one. Okay, now you can increase the control authority by increasing the velocity, by frequency, by the time period. Those are the things that you can do. By the change in the geometry, you can spread or you can make it narrower. All right, these things will affect the drag. We are not using it right now for separation control or anything. Okay. I'm not the leader, I know. Experiment CFD and time accurate CFD, you can get more details. So now it is a phase average. This is a the various they really don't do anything. But means but the final those velocity profile and the area that they affect. Because if you look at the skin friction. Skin friction is directly proportional to the velocity gradient, right? So we are not measuring the shear stress directly. So we are velocity measuring the velocity gradient from which you can calculate the shear stress and which is nothing but the drag. So the velocity profile is this is just give you a qualitative picture. Going on. What are you what out of so much of effort in time and energy as an outcome of your effort? And this is this chart actually. But the other charts are important because you get some idea what is happening. Okay, so I gave you this example already, you know, in the very first day, that this sweeping actuator has really now is a part of the 757 tail. And as I told you that if you go on the Google, it is all over the place because it was considered as a major accomplishment. Okay, so it is going to happen more and in a kind of sanitized form, you know, there is a paper that also you can look at it and it is also downloadable from the web. All right, so I'm not going to repeat what we already did. This is a model that was used in the wind tunnel and these are the way the jets were put in and there were 37 actuators. That is, there means 37 sweeping jets. So can you believe that how many points it may have required to do the CFD simulation? We didn't do it, but somebody did it. It requires about 2 to 10 million points to get the 37 jets going, and that jets a periodic boundary condition was imposed. So these are some of the, you know, results for 37 actuators. But you see that the thing that matter is that how much momentum was put in. Okay. So what is the coefficient here? This is of course AFC off, this is AFC in, on. So if you remember that all the results that I showed you in last 2 days, what was the momentum coefficient of the synthetic jet actuators? 1 point? Somebody says 0 point something, right? So it was more or like, you know, 0.05, 0.15. So the synthetic jet actuators have a lot more momentum, and that is the reason, no, these sweeping actuators, and that is why they are the new way to do it. Of course, they require more energy, but that is worth it. So the synthetic jet, I was telling you repeatedly, this is my opinion. But the people who are still working at it, you know, if they see me, they will shoot me. Okay, but this is the truth, that they just don't have the enough control authority to do a job for a real big application. So this is the way it is going to be for a while. But unless until, you know, I'm not saying this is the end of the road. If you guys have many brilliant ideas, that may be the next area of actuators. You know that whole wind tunnel model, grip that was done. Mechanic. Fighter program for Boeing, but you know we cannot show those results. But the bottom line is that the new technology in sweeping jets and what are the issues, and there are similar issues that were for the synthetic jet. Okay? So since we have been talking about synthetic jets for last 2.5 days, I thought that, you know, we should now cover the next frontier. Okay? So this is actually close this part. So I think that if you have questions, let us talk about it. And then next topic I want to cover is a basic idea of tolerance models, because I have this feeling that, you know, most of you have not, although you are running ANSYS, have gone to the level that you understand why, what turbulence model is and why is it important and what is the state of the art in turbulence model. So that is a lecture number 5 that we will try to do. So I don't know, break and then come back.